then there is the response in a different way. When there is water mixed with clay, the response will be in the clay and the water put together. But when the water is distilled, whenever the water is stirred, there is no clay coming in the way. Similarly, when your emotions are distilled, when you have the distilled experience medium in you, distilled experience medium means the medium through which experience is understood, then there will be no clay coming as a cloud on the way. Such a state is called inspiration. And whenever you make any conversation with such a person, the result is not emotion, but it is a higher equivalent of emotion. It is what we call devotion. Devotion is pure and emotion is muddy and mixed with clay of our animal nature. When the stir is mixed with animal nature, we call it emotion. When it is free from the animal nature, we call it devotion. That is the difference. There is the difference in the results and attitude also. Emotion is temporary and changes in its tidal waves from time to time. Devotion is not changing and the attitude continues and as long as we live. That is the difference between devotion and emotion. When I am having an emotional liking towards you, immediately I will have a reason to hate you very strongly. Daily I will be strongly liking and disliking persons. I will make many friends in the day and lose many friends in the day. At the end of my life, I do not find a real friend. That is the result of emotion. When we like you, I will like you in an animal way. And when I like you, I begin to possess you. And I expect that you should behave according to my likes and dislikes. That is what is called animal way of liking. If you behave in your own way, immediately I am reacted violently and I begin to hate you very strongly. This is the result of thought force induced by emotion. And when I am having only devotion and not emotion, I do not try to possess you. I will have the benefit of your presence and the happiness of your presence. And gradually I will go to such a level that I can enjoy all these scenes in this world. Everything in this world becomes a music. Just as we like roses even though there are spines, we do not hate the spines, but we like the roses. We will be careful about the thorns and we will enjoy the smell and color of the roses. Similarly, automatically we will be careful of the astral and emotional fellows around us. We will not respond to their animal behavior. And we will enjoy the whole cluster of mankind. That is the result of devotion. In Sanskrit, devotion is called bhakti. The process of practicing devotion is called bhakti yoga. It is one of the best methods of thought pruning. Thought pruning, that is, and shaping our thoughts and producing beautiful architectures of our thought. So, thought power is the ultimate power which produces everything when properly produced and destroys everything in an ugly manner when wrongly produced. Now, let us try to understand how a thought is produced in us. Let us try to understand how a thought is produced. When a thought is produced in our mind, we know that there is a thought. It travels in our mind into the form of a full idea. It selects a sentence in our mind and selects proper words for the sentence and selects the syllables required in our own language. And then it is externalized in the form of a sentence. That is a vocal sentence. Now let us go back from the vocal sentence and try to trace it. Before the vocal sentence we speak out, we have the mental sentence completely prepared. Just as before this glass is produced, there is this glass in the mind of the person who wants to produce it. So it is called thought sentence or mental sentence. It exists in the language in which we are trained. My mental sentence exists in my language and my friend's mental sentence exists in his language, French. Like that, the mental sentence of everyone exists as his own language mental sentence. This is the previous step of the vocal sentence uttered. Then, before this language mental sentence, the sentence will be there without the language. First, the sentence descends into the mind, into thought language, which is universal. Everyone gets the same thought language, and then it is translated into the personal language. So we have the vocal sentence uttered in our own language, and before that we have the mental sentence in our language, and before that we have the mental sentence above the language. Then it exists as a thought. Before that, how does it exist? How it exists? How does the thought exist before that stage? We have our thoughts in our mind, and before the thoughts came out, where were they and in what form they were existing? Before the wave emerges in the ocean, where was the wave? How did it exist? The answer is, there was no wave, only the ocean existed. When the wave came out, now there are two items, the ocean and the wave. Before the wave emerged, there was only one item, the ocean and no wave. Similarly, after the thought emerged from our mind, there are two items, our mind and the thought. Before the thought emerged, there was only one item, the mind. That means the thought is ourself. Thought existed in ourselves and thought was ourself. So similarly, this whole world started as a thought and expressed itself into the form of all this creation. Before it expressed, it was in the form of a thought. Before the form of thought took place, it was in the total. This is what exactly means by the mantra in the Gospels. That means, first there was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. That is what the Holy Bible teaches us. But we should be in a position to understand it. First of all, we should be in a position to understand where our thought existed. We have to make a study of the origin of our own thoughts. Then we should become familiar with the origin of our thought. And then gradually you will understand how the whole creation came, and then only you will have the real stature to understand the gospel. Otherwise, we will read the sentence in the gospel and try to understand it in our own poor way. Or sometimes we may think that the sentence is a mystic sentence or some cryptic sentence. Or sometimes we may also think that the sentence does not mean much. The scriptures are those books which contain such thoughts. Other books contain good thoughts, but the scriptures contain the thoughts which are the authors themselves. The author himself exists as the thought in the scripture. And when you approach the scriptural sentences properly, you will understand that you are approaching the author and not a book. So there is a subtle science to approach the authors who lived in the past ages. This is how to know the origin of your own thought. Every day you begin to think of your own thoughts and observe how they are born, how they emerge from your mind. You will understand that you are the background and your thoughts come out of the background. They begin to travel outside and they will be externalized, and they begin to produce their effects upon others and upon us. Day by day you will understand what the power of thought is. Day by day you will understand how you are making disturbance in the thought ocean of the world. And a great responsibility lies before you. It is like the responsibility of the person who drives a ship through the ocean. The pilot of the ship is not only responsible for his life, but is responsible for the life of all the passengers in the ship. Similarly, you have the responsibility of tackling the thought power of others around you. If you do not know this, you are not fit to have a wife and children, or a husband and children, because you will be wrongly disturbing the thought force, thought power of others. When you know this, you will begin to produce a thought architecture in the name of your family, in the name of the family. And the family serves as a sacred school to every one of the family, including yourself. When every member of the family begins to undergo this training in his own laboratory of his mind, under his own direction and the guidance of the incidents that are taking place in the family, then we have a great science at our disposal, of which we have never known at all previously. When we do not know, how can the universities know that such a science exists? When we do not know, how the university professors can know that such a science exists? When they do not know, how can they train their students into such a science? Because they are not able to train their own children. They are receiving their salaries to train the children of others. So, the future universities will be in a different path. If we can imagine a university in the middle of the 21st century, we can very easily understand that the students of that university will go to the museum and see the pictures of the 20th century university student and professor, and they laugh with themselves and they speak to each other. Long, long ago in the 20th century, there used to live foolish professors and foolish students. The students were making strikes against professors and the professors were trying to punish the students. In fact, it was a university of savage mankind, that is Paleolithic humanity. That is what they remark when they go to the university museum and see the pictures of the 20th century professor and the student. When once the force of thought is properly understood, there will be a big gulf between his understanding and our understanding. Within a very short future, there is going to be such a humanity, but they stand always the risk of being trained by ourselves. They stand always the risk of being trained by fellows like ourselves. Because if they happen to be our children, they receive only the foolish training we give to them. And if we happen to be their professors, they will receive the foolish education we impart to them. And the result is, once again, international war crisis in every generation. So there will be a big gulf between our generation and the 21st century generation. Soon, the understanding of humanity is becoming more and more. And the truth of thought power has began to dawn upon man, started to dawn upon mankind since the middle of the 20th century. But since the advanced humanity are only limited in number, the subject is gaining speed very slowly. And humanity is being divided into two halves gradually. The first part is humanity of intelligence, and the second part is humanity of understanding. Previously, we confused our intelligence with our understanding. Now, people are making a difference between intelligence and understanding. Without the capacity to understand each other properly, intelligence is only a mental disease. It leads only to nervousness and psychological disorders. The more knowledge we gain with our intelligence, the more will be the hypertension in our heads. When we begin to understand each other and understand the force of thought production and clearly understand the difference between intelligence and understanding, then the burden of our head will be removed. The more information we gather, the lighter will be our head and there will be no hypertension at all. Gradually, the coming generation are trying to understand this, but they have a practical difficulty. That is the presence of the people of our generation. We are behaving in our own way and we are trying to live in the world with our intelligence, and they are trying to learn to live with understanding and not intelligence. The gulf between the two branch groups of humanity is becoming bigger and bigger. And the result is either war or a new land inhabited by the new generation of all nations. Because our generation will not leave the foolishness to understand mankind with all the difference. For example, the Occidents and the Orientals, the Swiss, the French and the Belgian and the German. We understand only people in the light of our differences. So we are no more useful to the next generation. So there should be a handful of people from all the nations who propose that they should have a land of their own, and from all the nations, a new nation may be proposed. And it is not impossible for the next generation, though it is a dream and impossibility to the present generation, because we live in a world of thinkers and dreamers. We are neurotic, having nervous tension and emotion. So great things are not possible to us, and if at all any great thing is possible to our generation, it is only war. So the new generation finds it possible to discover such a solution. Then they will develop a university to study thought power. They will have studies of thought structures and thought architecture, and then the present books written on thought by the masters of wisdom will be used in the university. For example, Leadbeater has written a book of thought forms as early as 70 years ago. That means I was not born when that book was written. And many of the people who sit here are not born at all. The book contains how forms of thought are produced, how horrible thoughts produce horrible forms, how harmonious thoughts produce harmonious forms, how emotional thoughts produce dark color effects like blood red color and jet black color, deep black color, blood red color and deep black color. And thoughts produced in a benevolent way and artistic way produce color effects of beautiful color combinations. And how to produce good thoughts to neutralize the effects of bad thoughts, all these things are written in that book. And a practical training is proposed in the book. If you study the book on occult meditations by Alice A. Bailey, you will find how thought forms produce color forms, and meditations on color produce corresponding thought. There are as many as 200 books written on the subject till today by advanced thinkers of the age, those who are born a bit before the age, and now their books are dormant. They are in the foundations of humanity, and gradually they are becoming more and more popular day by day. It is difficult for us to make those books popular very immediately, because our minds are conditioned by religion and politics. We are almost prisoners of political thought and religious thought. And a generation which knows freedom will come to understand these books and establish a study of these books for students, and establish the 21st century universities to make a systematic study of thought force, and prepare experts in producing systematic thought, and use the power of thought for the happiness and the play and the game of thought, and not at all for a battle of thoughts which produces a battle on the physical plane. Finally, I want to point out a peculiar reflection upon thought force which is given in one of the world scriptures. If you study the 15th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, you will see the description of a strange tree. There is a tree with its branches downwards and the roots upwards. The roots are being produced up into the sky, and the branches are produced downwards into the earth. Such a tree has been described in the 15th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. It will be the first lesson in the 21st century universe. And there will be four more lessons, which we now call the four Gospels of the New Testament. Unfortunately, now we are studying these books as religious books. But they are books of mankind, and they are not books of any religion. It is the littleness of our mind that makes us think that the Gospels belong to Christianity, the Bhagavad Gita belongs to Hinduism, and the Voice of the Silence belongs to Buddhism, because we are not yet fit to read those books. But they are books of wisdom to all mankind, and they will be studied, and Bhagavad Gita will be studied not as books of religion, but books of advanced science, advanced subjective sciences. See how this tree is described. What are the causes of the tree? The causes are the roots. What are the results of the tree? The results are the branches. So there is a tree with its causes above and results below. That means our life is a tree with its causes as our thoughts and results as our deed. Meditate upon this tree. You will know the science of thought power. So whatever thoughts we produce will be germinated into the trees, having the branches and branches produced, and each branch produces its own flower, each flower produces its own fruit, each fruit produces its own seed, each seed produces its own, each seed produces its own root once again, and each root produces its own tree again. See how the cyclic process goes on. Each thought produces an act in you. Each act produces a conditioning of your mind, and a conditioned way of the blossoming of the mind.